Well, welcome to the Ransom Church and to week four of our series, Soul Shift. Before we start today, I am going to firmly plant both of my feet on my soapbox for just a minute. As you've heard, we are starting to invite people to, you know, digitally reserve your spot for Easter, and we're so excited that we get to actually have Easter in person this year. It was a year ago. We were wrestling with whether or not we'd be able to have service, ended up not being able to have it in person. But the opportunity does exist. And so I'm going to use this for me as an opportunity to challenge those of you who are watching from home, okay? There are a lot of reasons to be watching from home. Some of them are legitimate. Some of them are not, okay? If you are home and you are watching for a legitimate reason, health reasons, those types of things, you're just not ready to come out. We honor that, we respect that, and that's why we have this online available for you. But I just want to talk to those who you've been watching from home and it started legitimately, and if you're honest with yourself, your reason for not rejoining is not legitimate. If that's you, I want Easter to be your reason to come back. I want Easter to be your reason to come home, okay? If you feel safe, but you're just honestly choosing convenience of watching in your jammies at home because it's easy, I want to challenge you to do the hard thing because you need the body of Christ. Okay, I'm going to be off my soapbox now. I'm going to move on, but consider yourself called out. So here we go. Again, we're in week four of our series, Soul Shift. If you've been paying attention at all on this journey, you may have picked up on a pattern in these shifts, okay? None of these shifts, none of these monumental shifts that God wants us to make that we're talking about in this series have me shifting towards myself. Every single shift that God wants to make in you and in me as he does an ongoing sanctifying work in our lives is a shift away from me and towards him or towards others. And though the temptation exists to maybe want to skip all of these things or ignore all of them for this one today, that will be a great temptation. I want to set up the topic with a test. I want everyone in the room, I want you to raise your hands like you're in the middle of worshiping God right now. Whatever that looks like to you, I know some are a little more reserved than others, but I want you to raise your hands. If you raise them like this, if you raise them like this, whatever you do, and then I want you to look around the room at everybody whose hands are raised, and I want you to notice something. Everyone's hands are open. Now you can put your hands down. When I was preparing for this message, a lot of times I'll talk to the staff, I'll get ideas from them, and I asked Pastor Jared Bell, hey Jared, if you could tell people one thing about this topic, if you could give them one thing, what one statement would you make? And here's what Jared said. He said, there's a reason we worship with open hands and not closed fists. Listen, folks, worship is something that we do open-handed. And we get the picture for sure. Worship is about surrender. But our core value is not just to worship free, but to worship free of inhibition. In other words, we don't come to God closed-fisted, inhibited, holding on to things. We come to him with a spirit and in an act of surrender to him. And that sets us up perfectly for our topic for today. Stewardship. Right? Today's shift is from consumer to steward, and you might think, whoa, you took a left turn on me there, Pastor Phil. Let me clear up any confusion you might be having. Worship is about surrender, right? And biblical stewardship is a beautiful expression of worship. So why is it that we come to God open-handed in worship, but we become closed-fisted when the conversation about stewardship comes up? Today we're going to address God's heart for stewardship, and yeah, certainly that's over our finances, but it's not only over our finances. We're called to steward our time, we're called to steward our talents or our gifts, we're called to be good stewards of our relationships, to steward our family well. In so many areas of life, we're called to steward well. And in order to clear this up, I want to illustrate this for us, and I want to give one common picture to kind of tie the message together. I'll lay out the picture, and then I'm going to jump into the text. So here's the picture. I have this piece of wood here. Okay, now let's say I'm going to build something out of wood. You may not believe I have the capability to do that, but whatever you believe about that, let's pretend for the sake of argument I'm building something grand out of wood. And let's say in the thing I'm building, it would require me to put a hole in this piece of wood? What tool would be the best tool for the job? It's not a trick question. It's sitting right here. It's a drill. Okay? I can use my drill to put a hole that I desire in the wood. It's the right tool for the right job. So I'm going to go Jesus style on you here with a parable, okay? Now, I'm not Jesus, so my parables are not good, but we're going to work with what we got. Money is like a drill. It's just a tool. So I have my drill here. Your drill is probably nicer because you have more money. Okay, but mine will certainly get the job done. It's going to be fine. We'll get a hole drilled. What am I after again? What am I trying to accomplish? What's my will for this wood? That there would be a hole in the wood. That's what I'm after. The drill is the right tool to make that happen. Well, money is simply a tool designed to be used to get a desired result. And the same could be said of our time. And the same could be said of our talents. The things God has blessed us with are tools that we are called to steward to get a desired result. Now, when you think about your life, that result could be an education. It could be a new car. It could be a gallon of milk. The money, the resource, is not the point. It's just a tool. Just like my drill is not the point. It's just a tool with a specific purpose. So if I went to the store and I bought drill after drill after drill and I lined up all these drills on a shelf in my garage, but I never drilled any holes with them, you'd think I'd lost my mind. Or at very least, you'd think that I'm missing the point. And it would be even crazier if I bought so many drills that the guy down the street couldn't get his hands on one, and then I wouldn't let him use my drills when he needed it. That's the mindset of consumerism. I recently read a statistic on American consumerism that said that we spend about $200 billion a year on advertising, and a large portion of that advertising is actually advertising food, while on a global scale, estimates say that $300 billion a year would eliminate world hunger in less than 10 years. So when you think about it, we spend more money trying to help us decide what to eat than we do on feeding those who are starving to death. Now, that's not laying a guilt trip on anyone or anything like that. I just want to put consumerism in perspective for us. You can understand why the heart of God, why God's call is to shift from consumer to steward. So let me say that differently to bring our illustration in. Your role in life is to use the tool you've been given to drill holes, not to become a drill collector. That's the heart of God. These things we've been given have been given to us for the purpose that He gave it, not to keep them all for ourselves. So to steward something simply means to manage the property or the affairs for someone other than yourself. Okay, so this may shock you, but nothing you have in life is actually yours. Not your house, not your cars, not your possessions, not your money, not your spouse or your kids or even your own life. They're all just things that we've been entrusted with in order to carry out God's will for our lives. And you might be thinking, well, I worked hard for what I have. I worked hard for everything I have, and that may very well be the case, but please understand, the gifts, talents, and abilities and opportunities that you have in life that made it possible for you to work hard and earn what you have all came from Him to begin with. They all belong to Him, and so do you. In Deuteronomy chapter 8, verse 18, we read this. Remember the Lord your God. He is the one who gives you power to be successful in order to fulfill the covenant He confirmed to your ancestors with an oath. Here's the point. It's not yours. It's His. It's always been His. It'll always be His. You're just a steward. And that's a significant shift from our culture, to say the least. In fact, I would say it's exactly opposite of our culture. Our culture is 100% built around consumerism. Everything in this life would tell you to consume all you can for yourself. And as I was preparing this message, I racked my brain to find the perfect parable in Scripture to teach you, to convince you to ignore the pull of the world and to choose a life of biblical stewardship. I was looking for something inspiring, you know, hopefully a tearjerker. And as I prayed, God reminded me of a parable. He said, that's what I want you to talk about. And it wasn't anything like what I was looking for. It wasn't the passage I wanted to preach at all, but it's exactly where we need to go today. So turn with me to Luke chapter 16, if you will. If you're using one of our Bibles, we'll be on page 628. This is known as the parable of the unjust steward, or the parable of the dishonest manager. Now, typically, I love the book of Luke and its narratives, but this is one of the strangest parables in the Bible. And I don't want to spoil it, so let's dive right in. Luke chapter 16, starting with verse 1. It says, Jesus told this story to his disciples. There was a certain rich man who had a manager or a steward handling his affairs. One day a report came that that manager was wasting his employer's money. So the employer called him in and said, what is this I hear about you? Get your report in order because you are going to be fired. Okay, now this picture of a steward may be foreign to us. It would have been common for the listeners at the time. It was very normal at the time for a wealthy landowner to hire someone to serve as their steward and to manage all of their wealth and to manage all of their resources. And as you can imagine, if you're going to entrust somebody to manage those things, you probably need to trust them, okay? And yet it's very common at the time among stewards of the day to be skimming off the top, to be overcharging sometimes and taking the excess for themselves, often to the point where they would blur the lines in their mind and they would begin to forget that everything that they were looking over was not theirs. It actually belonged to the master. And that's exactly what this steward has been doing. And the master gets a report one day that this manager is wasting money or stealing or skimming off the top or overcharging, and he lets his employee know, you're going to be fired. Now, here's the good news, and this is a parable about you and me, right? The good news is God's not firing us, okay? But you can hear yourself in these statements, can't you? How often have I been guilty of treating everything that I have as if it was mine rather than a gift from him? How often have I been angry at God because of where I am financially? How often have I been scared to let my kids go on a big trip, adventure trip, like adventure trip with Ransom Teens, or go away to college far away where God is calling them, simply because I'm treating them like they're mine and I want to keep them close? For me, this is hitting pretty close to home right now. Now, the manager begins to share his thoughts, and it just cracks me up. Look at verse 3. You would think the manager was going to support himself. Listen to what he says. The manager thought to himself, well, now what? My boss has fired me. I don't have the strength to dig ditches, and I'm too proud to beg. Like, that doesn't make the steward look any better at all, okay? We already learned that he's selfish and dishonest. Now we learn he's also, by his own admission, lazy and super proud. In other words, this guy is not the role model. He's not a great role model. And the reality is, it's easy to get to this place in life where we view all that we steward as if it's ours, whether we've been trusted with a lot or a little. It's easy to get comfortable. It's easy to get entitled with our place in life to the point where we get lazy and a bit proud too. But one day, here's the reality, we will all give an account of our stewardship. And that's not a heaven and hell issue. Everyone, sinner and saint alike, will stand before God and will give an account of our stewardship, of what we did with the time and the talents and the treasures, how we used the influence he provided us, whether we truly learned to serve for yourself. I, for one, want to stand before the God I love, having been a good steward of what he entrusted me with. I want to have drilled the holes he wanted me to drill, so to speak, not use the resources to become a drill collector. So the steward has two options here. Option one is the one that probably seems most reasonable by our standards, and that is to rationalize what he's done, okay? Well, I can't do what you're asking with what you gave me. I need to put food on my table. I need to provide for my family. I don't have that kind of time. I can't volunteer for that. I don't have that kind of margin in my schedule. Now, certainly there's nothing wrong with providing for your family or with guarding your time or saving for the future. But haven't we all been guilty of rationalizing our lifestyle and our time and the way we, as an excuse for not being more generous, more involved, more obedient when God calls? The steward could easily have taken that option. Instead, he opts for option number two, and it is crazy. Let's pick it up in verse 4. The steward says, I know how to ensure that I'll have plenty of friends who will give me a home when I'm fired. So he invited each person who owed money to his employer to come and discuss the situation. He asked the first one, how much do you owe him? The man replied, I owe him 800 gallons of olive oil. So the manager told him, take the bill and quickly change it to 400 gallons. And how much do you owe my employer? He asked the next man. I owe him 1,000 bushels of wheat, was the reply. Here, the manager said, take the bill and change it to 800 bushels. Now, do you see what he's doing here? At first glance, it is hard to see any redeeming quality in this story. It looks like he's ripping off his boss by settling debts at a much lower rate with people who do not owe him money but owe his boss money. So he brings in the people who are deeply in debt to the master, and he cuts their bill by a significant percentage. Why would he do that? Because in Israel, they operated on what would be considered a you owe me type of culture. So favors that were done on your behalf were expected to be paid back. So he was doing a bunch of favors for these indebted people, so they'll literally owe him one. Here's what I think is actually happening here. I don't want you to miss this. There are many scholars who think that the portion he's cutting off of people's bills is actually the commission that he had been taking for himself. He's been taking that resource, he's been overcharging and keeping it for himself. You could say it's what he's been stealing from either the master or the people that are paying the bills, and he's taking what he's been ripping people off, and he's distributing that back to those who need it. Sort of the way that Zacchaeus paid back what he had taken when he came to Christ. And the response of the rich owner is shocking, because either way, this is a pretty shady deal. The response of the rich owner is shocking. Verse 8, the rich man had to admire the dishonest rascal for being so shrewd. And it is true that the children of this world are more shrewd in dealing with the world around them than are the children of the light. Now, does that seem right to you at all? This seems completely backwards. It's like God is happy with what happened here. Shrewd is the word phronimos. It means mindful of one's interests. So someone who is shrewd is someone who's paying attention. It's someone who's coming up with a plan, sees what's coming and is making wise moves in order to prepare for what's ahead, okay? So let me go all the way back to our original picture. Money isn't the point. Money's just a tool, right? For someone whose focus is solely on their own benefit, how they use the tool will be different than how we should use the tool. Is that fair? Because they don't see the values of the kingdom. They don't value the things of the kingdom. So this shrewd manager is on that side of things. He used money as a tool to make sure that his life was taken care of. But those of us who claim to be children of God, our value is not meant to be found in this earth, but in advancing the kingdom of God. And so Jesus finally gives the moral of the story in verse 9. He says, here's the lesson. Use your worldly resources to benefit others and make friends. Then when your possessions are gone, they will welcome you into an eternal home. Okay, this is what I want you to get out of this whole sermon. This is the powerful picture of the shift in a mindset from a consumer living only for the things of this world to a true kingdom steward. So it says here that people will welcome you into an eternal home. If they are welcoming you into an eternal home or into heaven, then clearly these are people who are now saved. So what Jesus is saying here is that we are to use everything that we have, money, time, talent, family, resources, all of our worldly resources, we're to use them whenever possible to benefit others, to serve free of self, to invest our lives in others, because one day it will all be gone. All our time, all our talent, all our money, all our family, and we will have invested it in something. Either we will have given it to make our lifestyle as comfortable as humanly possible, or we will have used it as a tool for his kingdom to resource and benefit others around us in a way that leads them to a saving knowledge of Jesus. So here's what this statement really comes down to. This is God's purpose for all he's giving you. Consumers use all they've been given. They literally consume it for themselves and their own pursuits, everything. Stewards manage all they've been given. They realize that what they have doesn't belong to them. They've been entrusted with it by their master, and their role is to carry out his will in this life, using the resources they've been given by God as tools to carry out his will in the world. God wants us to invest what we've been given here on earth in the pursuit of the expansion of his kingdom rather than just spending it all on earth on stuff. And yes, we do that by investing in ministry and mission, no doubt, by tithing and being generous to our local church, but we also do it by investing time and energy and money into our neighbors, into those who are lost and hurting in our life. We do it by giving significant time spiritually leading our family and by taking time to disciple our kids to get to know him and what it means to live free of sin, which is why our kids ministry provides these beacon boxes to actually help you steward your kids' souls. This is why we give our time meeting our disciples week after week or being in a group, pouring into others for the sake of the gospel. We use our worldly resources, our home, our evenings, our family. We use them to benefit others, to pour ourselves out relationally, and we do so all for the sake of the gospel. Listen, shifting from a consumer to a steward is not a shift from spending to saving. It's a shift in how we spend. Let me make a bold statement here. God's intention for your money is that you spend it. Now, I know every financial advisor that I know, including my own, who also happens to be my father-in-law, is waiting for me to clarify what in the world I mean. So let me explain what I'm saying here. I'm not saying you should never save money. Okay, meeting with a financial advisor is a good thing. But the reason that we work with my father-in-law to plan for our future is not just so we can live large someday. It's so that we can invest in the things of the kingdom that God calls us to, which includes caring for and providing for our family, but also includes so many kingdom causes that we give to. When we begin to hoard money just for the sake of having more of it, seeing the money, seeing it as the place we find security and confidence, we have a consumer and not a steward mindset. Because money is not the point. It's just a tool given to us to help us carry out God's will for our lives. And every one of us has a choice where and how we'll invest our money and our time and our resources, and a shift from consumer to steward simply changes priorities. From investing in me to investing in his kingdom. Because when you stand before God, it won't matter what you owned on this earth. When you stand before God, it won't matter how nice your lifestyle was. You don't get to take any of it into eternity. But when you invest in kingdom impact, one day when all your material wealth is gone and when your lives end and you stand before God, we will give an account of our eternal investments. As we meet the people who came to know Jesus simply because we gave our time and our resources and our talents and our energies to the work of God's kingdom, to the work of his agenda. Everything we have, everything we are, has redemptive potential. And God just wants to shift us from the mindset of a consumer to the mindset of a manager. You know what? It's all his. God, whatever you ask, I'll do. I'll give. I'll do it for the growth of the kingdom and for the salvation of the lost. Now listen, no one here thinks this is a bad thing. I don't think anyone's listening and going, no, investing in people's eternity is bad. That's a bad investment. I think most people are going, yeah, absolutely. I want that. I think investing in eternity is good. I'm guessing most people are saying, I would love to be more generous with my time and my energy and my finances. But the reason that this takes a complete soul shift is because it's so easy to talk ourselves out of it. The number one excuse people have, no matter how much money they have, for not giving is that giving and generosity is a beautiful thing, but I don't have enough margin in my budget. I don't have enough to give anything right now. And Jesus knows that excuse is coming, and he addresses it starting in Luke 16, verse 10. He says, if you are faithful in little things, you will be faithful in large ones. But if you are dishonest in little things, you won't be honest with greater responsibilities. And if you are untrustworthy about worldly wealth, who will trust you with the true riches of heaven? So see, apparently worldly wealth isn't the true riches of heaven. He says, and if you're not faithful with other people's things, why should you be trusted with things of your own? Here's the point. Here's what we need to see. Worldly wealth is the little thing. It's the thing. It doesn't matter how much or little you have. In comparison to eternity, money just doesn't matter. Being a good steward isn't about having an abundance. It's about knowing the master's will for what you have. Giving is not about having extra. Giving is about two things, faithfulness and loyalty. Those are the only two issues. Stewardship isn't about surplus, it's about faithfulness. How faithful are you with what you've been given? Are you treating all you have as if it's the point or as if it's a tool to steward his kingdom purposes? Are you using what he entrusted you in the way he wants it to be used? Absolutely, be sure to take care of your family. Live in a house that you can afford. Drive a car that you can afford. If you can afford to, go on vacation that you can afford. Save for the future. All of that's great, but make sure that you leave enough margin in life that when the master speaks, whatever he asks, you'll be able to listen. Remember, none of it is yours. You're a steward. The unjust steward saw his master's resource as a means for his enjoyment and advancement and eventually to save his own hide. Jesus says, I want you to be just as shrewd, but I want you to be a just steward. I want you to recognize that all you have belongs to God, and I want you to use his resources as a tool to further kingdom goals. Ultimately, all comes down to verse 13. No one can serve two masters, for you will hate one and love the other. You'll be devoted to one and despise the other. You cannot serve God and be enslaved to money. Listen, worship is surrender, and stewardship is a beautiful form of worship. Worshiping free is choosing to live life open-handed, not consuming all we have been given for ourselves, but stewarding well the tools we've been given. But let me ask you a really important question, because this is ultimately the foundation. What's your opinion of the master? Because the shift that needs to be made will only be made when you see the will of the master as more important than the wants of your heart. If your primary concern is wealth, it can't be Jesus. And if your primary concern is Jesus, it can't be wealth. Money's not meant to be hoarded, it's meant to be spent on the kingdom. Money's not to be loved, it's to be used for the kingdom. Money's not to be collected, it's just a tool for kingdom purposes. Money's not the point, the kingdom is the point. That's stewardship according to Jesus.
The shift that needs to be made will only be made when you see the will of the master as more important than the wants of your heart. I don't know what kind of steward you have been, but there's good news. It's never too late to change. There's still time to shift in your soul. God wants to turn consumers into stewards today. He wants to entrust to you all that you have, entrust you to steward it well for the kingdom. What stewardship step do you need to take today? It's easy to focus on money. Often we want to think of stewardship as saving it and keeping the purse strings nice and tight. But God doesn't want that. He wants us to see the needs of his people and be able to help them wherever they are, to be able to pour into those that are struggling in times of need. And what does that look like for you? Maybe money's not your problem. Maybe you have no problem giving to organizations and helping feed children across the ocean and in Africa somewhere. Or what does it look like to be able to send other people on mission trips? But have you given your time, your skills, your giftings? Have you given them in a stewardful manner? Or are you more consuming? Perhaps binging on Netflix is something that occupies your time more so than looking out for the people that are right down the street. That could be looking for someone to talk to, that you might seem to be too busy to get too personal into relationships. Maybe we need to steward our time better so that we can pour into the lives of those around us. Whatever that looks like to you, I encourage you to see what God sees, to look and find opportunities, to be able to steward whatever it is in your life to help God's kingdom. Would you pray with me? Jesus, this is one of the more challenging things to talk about because it gets real personal. When we're talking about our own time, our personal things that we want to hold to ourselves. But God, when we let those loose, when we believe and understand that whether it be money that we deal with, whether it be our skills, our talents, our giftings, our time, when we get in the mindset that it is not our own, but it is something that you have given us so that we can steward well with it, God, it totally transforms what can be done with it. And often it multiplies in ways that we could never imagine as far as the amount of kingdom impact that it can have. So God, I pray that you would change us to become more and more stewards of all that you give us. May we run away from being consumers so that we can focus on building your kingdom. It's in your great name that we pray. Amen.